That's very good.
Well, I haven't been in Belfast for a little while now. You know what? Actually, I think one of the last times that I came here was to hang out with a friend of mine, Tony. Tony, where are you? You're here, aren't you?
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yes, sir.
There he is. Yeah. Yeah, I think that was a few years ago.
Yeah.
Mm. And I know a few other friends here this evening. It's,
Oh.
Thank you. Thank you. We were told the streets were paved with gold. So our people came by air and sea to earn our money. They could keep, then fly back home. Sadly, that never came to be. When we learned we had just been invited to clean up after the war. Back in 49, never intended to stay here. Who could afford to leave these shores? Born and raised this way. By culturally, fresh directions, new ideas, opening our eyes and ears, allowing us to save our day. No more frustration. Pushed back in isolation. Positive creativity, finding ourselves aching. Aching to be set free. No longer linger and stew in the mind. No longer rational, well thought out answers. Did you read the article or did you just read the headline? Click wars, click, 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 click wars, click, 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 click. It's much more mightier than pen. Ego is fully alive. Bringing all cylinders, never a pause to consider others, but to be first off the block, to be first off the block. Click, 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 wars. Armchair theater, click, wars. The battle for the last word. The battle's for the last word. It can extend deep into the night. become so narcissistic, you don't even recognize that you're now talking to your damn self. Deep into the night. The click is much more mightier than the pen. Much more mightier than the pen. Thank you.
Hello, good evening. You might think you've heard what happened that night in Grenfell. Hello, good evening. You might think you've heard what happened that night in Grenfell Tower. Hello, good evening. You might think you've heard what happened that night in Grenfell Tower 3 months ago. In the immediate aftermath of the fire, we brought you the story of the tragedy, what we learned of the causes behind it, and of those who died. Tonight, we step back, conscious perhaps of how little we really knew about who the people who lived there actually were and what they went through. Each floor of that tower tells a story about London and its inhabitants, a story of immigration and gentrification, of lives lived and lives lost. Each floor, a microcosm of life in our capital. Our team spent weeks piecing together a comprehensive account of what happened that night on just one floor, high in Grenfell Tower, floor 21. In an extended film on tonight's programme, we reveal the anatomy of a community, those who lived and loved living up on the 21st floor, the lengths they went to save each other's lives, and the desperation they felt for those who never escaped. It's a powerful and at times disturbing account. Katie Brazel has reported on Grenfell Tower from the night of the fire, and she joins me now. Katie.
Well, Emily, Grenfell has come to mean many things to many people. A symbol of injustice, an indictment of how we treat the poor. Only today, Jeremy Corbyn raised the tragedy, put it at the very centre of his speech at the Labour Party conference, very much in those terms. But amongst the news coverage and the debate about how many people died, individual lives have perhaps lost the detail they deserve. So we've spent a long time piecing together the lives of a community on one floor, one of the top floors, the 21st. And we wanted to ensure that the people who died there are remembered for more than just the manner of their untimely deaths. We also wanted to know a little bit more about what it was like to live in Grenfell Tower. And, you know, based on the perhaps, you know, slightly one-dimensional coverage up to now, you might be surprised, viewers might be surprised by what people say. Now, one of the survivors that we spoke to is just 12. She showed immense courage on the night of the fire. And what she tells us is deeply upsetting, but it also offers a level of understanding we haven't had before. Now, in evaluating what to broadcast, we took advice from child psychiatrists and child trauma experts who are working with survivors at Grenfell. But of course, I have to warn you that our film is distressing.
For more than 3 months, its burnt out shell has stood. For more than 3 months, its burnt out shell has stood as testament to horror. But for decades, Grenfell was home. For more than 3 months, its burnt out shell has stood as testament to horror. But for decades, Grenfell was home. But for decades, Grenfell was home.
They were trying to say that it was a very poor tower, a broken tower, if you like, but it was far from that.
It's a community where everyone knows each other.
On the night of the fire, to some, the advice they were given and the decisions they took based on that advice were to make the difference between life and death.
My room was on fire. Just like that. All my curtains were on fire. My mother's basket was on fire. All that side of the window was all on fire.
So we're just trying to run. We're just, you know, just going. Just keep on going. Just keep on going.
Thick air going into you is really trying to find air.
I just can't believe that they're gone.
doing it in my shoes. Yes, my shoes. I've been pitching slightly. The shoes were my toes were squeezed and pitching. Hurting my feet. Pounding. I was pounding on concrete. Pounding in my shoes. Running, jogging in my shoes. Lift up your own weight. Pick up your own weight. Lift up yourself. A metaphor for living. After doing it in my shoes, I may have been pitching, they may have been pitching slightly, pounding away through the parks, through the riverbanks, mostly on concrete where bone and cartilage were going to eventually meet each other. It all ended abruptly, of course. I'm glad it did, as my knees started to hurt. Before any serious damage was done, I quit. Jogging, trying to lift my own weight. Now we call metaphor for goodbye. Living, my two friends, my shilling, my giving, my willing to compromise. Jogging where bone and cartilage meet, going to eventually meet each other. It all ended abruptly, and I'm glad it did, as the knees started to hurt before.
This the other night in Poland. They really got it.
You'll understand why by the title it's called The Sober Drunk. The Sober Drunk. Has never been in movies, never been in movies, never had a part to play. The sober drunk, he'd rather play himself in the movies of his mind. He'd rather play himself, not another slave or gangster. No, the sober drunk, the sober drunk. Not another slave or a pimp or a robber. Not like the others, the sober drunk. So the sober drunk picks up the camera and starts to film everything. Everything in sight. All the sorrows, all the grief, all the pain, the pleasure too. The sober drunk starts the film. It starts to capture everything. All the moods, all the different variations, all the experiences, all the ups and downs. All the tragedies. All the disasters. Sober drunk. Everything becomes crystal clear because through the lens of his camera, he's able to see everything as clear as light. The sober drunk puts down the crack pipe, starts to man up now because the sober drunk is able to see a direct reflection of him or herself in the camera, in the mind's eye, in the camera of the mind. The mind's eye, which is the camera, which is the eye of the camera. The sober drunk is able to see everything very clearly, puts down the crack pipe and is able to fix everything for him or herself, because the sober drunk sees beauty in the reversed sound, reversed images that are now pulsating, that are now being captured within the lens that sober drunk is now able to function in his or her space and is able to man up and be the person they were designed to be. The sober drunk is now able to see crystal clearly what is going on in his world. The sober drunk is able to find his or her way and navigate something precious for him or herself. The sober drunk, sober drunk is now out of his or her funk. Sober drunk is not enough to testify or deny yourself. Your sober drunk is only interested. It's transformed quite a lot. It's hardly recognizable anymore. Everything has really sort of changed. And a lot of the places that I used to see as a kid, and, you know, Hackney had a lot of problems back in the day. But it's like really interesting because Hackney's now almost like turning into the West End. I mean, I'm seeing clothes shops in Hackney that you'd only see on King's Road. I was walking along there and I was stopped. I said, what the fuck? These shops are only in Chelsea and they're in Hackney? What is going on? It's really amazing what's going on. I didn't leave. to. I had to leave because I couldn't afford to stay. I was born there, spent most of my life there, never had any fears. Like, it's like the cosmopolitan epicenter, a mixture of so many different languages. If you walk from, like, if any of you don't know that part of London, if you walk from, I don't know, Camden and come all the way through Finsbury Park and to Manor House and Stamford Hill and Clapton, and you go through to Whitechapel, you'll see every nation on earth in that kind of 2-3 mile road. You know, just the community that I grew up amongst was Clapton, Upper Clapton, Springfield, was many of the Hasidic Jews community I grew up around, the Muslims that live side by side. So you have the Muslims, you have the Jews, and you have the African, you have the Caribbean communities, and you have all these different, you know, you have the Italian community, the Brazilians, and the Irish, and the Scottish, and the French, and you have this mixture, this stew of all these different cultures and all these different people living in a 2-3 mile radius, and it was incredible, and still is a mixture of so many different languages, like a stir fry dish that smells and tastes. That you're walking in Stonington and you see your favorite restaurant, your favorite Indian restaurant, or your Caribbean restaurant, or you're going to get some Jewish food. Yeah. the run, take a mouthful, or just enough that you can chew on and run. Take it, run with it, make with it what you will. Turn it into your passions, your dreams, your desires, your hopes. Bite what you need. Bite what you need and run. Run as far as you can. Take it wherever your heart desires, whatever you desire. Bite what you need and run. Run, run. Bite all you need and run. Bite all you need and run. Take it. Shape it. Make it what you will. The desires of your heart, your passions. Bite what you need and run. Run, don't let it stick. Don't let it stick. Don't let it entrap you, let it stick like bubblegum. Take it. Take a bite. Take all you need. A morsel, just a mouthful. Take it and run. Shape it, make it like plasticine. Stretch it like elastic. Make it what you train for. For you and your life and your family. Bite, take a bite. Take a bite and run. Take a mouthful, just a mouthful. Just all that you need, you don't need much. Just all you need, just a little bite, and run, take it. Just take it, anywhere. Take it around the world. The world is yours. The world is yours. The world is yours.
The world is yours.
Take it.
Thank you.